Hi, welcome to the EEVblog, an electronics engineering video blog of interest to anyone involved in electronics design. I'm your host, Dave Jones.
Hi, it's product review time again. I thought I'd do a quick review on these funky Samson 4i USB studio monitor speakers. Now, normally I wouldn't review a set of speakers because this is an electronic show, not an audiophile show. But these are the USB Connect ones, so they've got to have some electronics in them. So I thought I'd crack them open, see what's in there. So it's more of a teardown than a review, really. You won't get any audiophile wank words out of me. Maybe. The reason I went looking for a pair of USB studio monitor speakers is because, as you know, I do a lot of video editing. Sometimes some of my videos can have hundreds of clips in them, and that takes many, many hours to edit. And normally I do it with the headphones. Coincidentally, these are Samson as well. SR850, if you're after a decent, good quality pair of studio monitor headphones, cheap, highly recommend them. My Philips ones are crap. They died, wouldn't recommend those at all, but these Samsons are pretty good, which is why I had no hesitation getting Samson speakers as well. But yeah, the dynamic range of speakers is much better. You stick them on and they help seal out external noises, and then you can hear during video editing all the little nuances. I can hear the birds outside, I can hear if there's any mains hum or anything else directly in the headphones. They're really good, but sticking these on your head for hours and hours can, you know, it's not the most comfortable thing in the world. So if the wife's not home and I'm doing some editing, I'd rather use a decent pair of speakers. But those little crappy USB powered ones are absolutely useless. They're just, don't even start. They're just no good for video editing. You need a pair of what's called studio monitors. So I went searching, and these were one of the cheapest ones I could find around, actually, and they happen to be Samson, which is a reasonably decent brand of audio gear. So let's crack them open and see what's inside. On the back here, it looks like there's a bunch of external screws around the side like this, that this whole back panel should actually pop off, and I'm presuming all the electronics is attached to that. So let's give it a go. And the screws are just self-tappers into wood, but that's pretty much what I expected. Didn't expect anything more than that. Now this, I'm guessing, should pop off. I think I got all the screws out, maybe. No, I reckon. Oh, yeah, here it comes. Yep. Whee. Yes, exactly what I thought. Yep. Ta-da. There you go. There's the wiring and the electronics. And at first glance, I'm quite impressed. Really, it's there's a three-board construction. Here's the USB input board. There's the USB input connector. This is the line-in board over here, because these are the line-in jacks. And you've got your power amp down the bottom here. And I really like it. They've actually gone to a decent amount of trouble. You can see the USB here. They've actually glued everything down. These are really nice PCB attachments for the front panel, so it screws into the front panel like that, and it's just quite nice. They've done the same thing over here on the line-in board. As you can see, they've glued it all down, because glue in these sort of things is important, because it stops stuff vibrating. This is a speaker after all, and things will actually vibrate inside, so it's important to actually dampen that and secure things with glue. And you can see they've done the same thing with the speaker output terminals, the power on off switch, the voltage selection switch for 110 220, and also the mains input as well. And they're all heat shrunk, cable tied. Quite nice construction. As you can see, the power transformers down the bottom here. I really like it. As far as I was expecting a bit more down market for the price, really. And there's an SMSC USB 2512 USB hub IC, and up here we have a
Burr Brown slash TI PCM 2704. That's a USB DAC. And there's a couple of other devices around there. There's a couple of those up there actually not really had the numbers rubbed off, but they did have like some sort of marker actually put over them. I don't know, that might have been for testing purposes or something like that. But as you can see, the construction quality of the board is quite nice. The two crystals here, nice attention to detail. They've been soldered down to the board to prevent any vibration issues, so I rather like it. And the date code marker on the board is around mid-2008, so it's by no means a new model at all, but it is up to version 1.5, which shows you that they have done a few revisions of this board. And the line input board, nothing really majorly special at all, except for the op amp in there. It is a single inline SIP package. That's an NJM 4560 dual op amp. And there's no real surprises inside the box. There's some polyester filler material. There's a 4 ohm 20 watt speaker that is magnetically shielded. And up here you can see that they've actually got a separate box for the tweeter up in there, and it all looks quite nice. Once again, there's glue on various parts of the screws and things inside. There's wiring going down to the front panel controls down there, shielded wiring. I like it. And the ports on the back are actually tuned ports, as you can see, because they do actually have a specific length tube going back into the thing, and there's two of those, one on each side. And yes, it's wank word time. Here you go, time-aligned waveguide. Whoa. And magnetically shielded, of course, silk dome tweeter, co-polymer boodle surround woofer. That's a type of rubber, and 65 hertz to 23 kilohertz response. And rather nicely, they actually provide you with the SPL response graph on the back. I like it. Looks flat enough to me. And I'm not going to take out those top boards to get down to the power amp board down the bottom, but no surprises at all. Is one of those single chip packages, as you can see, tied onto the metal backplate for the heat sinking. And that's actually, I've had a look at that. That is a TDA 7265B 25 watt stereo amp. They've got there's the bridge rectifier. They've got the filter caps. Once again, they're actually stuck down as well, so they don't vibrate loose. This top line-in board is actually hooked onto the bottom one via a standoff there, which is quite nice, and I really like it. There's an inductor. It's got a funny-looking ferrite heat-shrinked shaft sticking out of it. I'm not quite sure what's going on there, but yeah, the construction is really quite nice. It looks a bit messy, but it really is not bad at all. I expected a lot worse, actually. And there's the power transformer, which is also magnetically shielded as well. And just when you thought that line input board was all through-hole stuff, no, if you have a look on the bottom here, there's some SMD stuff as well. There's even a SMD SO package on the bottom of that, and on the bottom of the power amp board there's also another package there, and a couple of surface mount devices as well. And let's take a look at the back of the unit, shall we? We've got our line in here, right and left channel. There's a small heatsink there, but it actually uses the entire metal back panel as a heatsink as well. You've got your USB input connector, you've got your speaker out to the left channel speaker. They're just little spring terminals, fairly typical. Power on off switch, great. Standard figure eight power input connector, and a 110 and 220 volt selection switch as well. So it's dual use around the world, and designed and engineered in the United States of America by Samson Technologies, but unfortunately made in China, of course. And of course the two tuned bass ports down the bottom as well. And if you take a look at the front of the unit, it's not unattractive at all. It's got a rather nice matte black sort of PVC vinyl covering on it. It's got the tweeter, of course, the 4-inch woofer on it. There is no mesh at all, so the speaker is totally exposed. It's got a volume control, it's got a power LED, it's got an auxiliary input and a headphone output on the front, which is really handy. One nice aspect of the volume knob, take a look at this. You can actually push it in, and you can rotate it, of course, but you can actually push it in as well, and that doesn't actually do anything. It just gets it out of the way so you don't bump it. So there's, you can set it to a specific, you can still turn it while it's pushed in, but it just allows you to get that control out of the way so you don't accidentally bump it. I like it. Nice touch. And of course, the other speaker which comes with it doesn't have any controls or power amplifier in there at all. It's got nothing on the back except the tuned bass ports and the terminals in. And it's far lighter than the other one, of course. And I forgot to mention the wank words as well. If we take a look at the manual, it's got a 4-inch polypropylene with Santoprene surround. Ooh, lovely. 1-inch silk dome ferrofluid neodymium tweeter. Lovely. Ah, I love it. And of course, the 4i and the 3i are different just in terms of the size is slightly different. It uses a 3-inch woofer as opposed to a 4-inch, and it's got 2x20 watts, and the frequency response, of course, is lower. It goes down to 65 hertz on the 4i unit. And they tell you about the high pass filter as well. It's at 4 kilohertz, 6 dB per octave Butterworth. They are PTC protected as well. And the low pass filter's at 1400 hertz, 12 dB per octave Linkwitz Riley. Gotta love the Linkwitz Riley. One of the things you really notice about the main power amp boxes, it's heft. It really is quite hefty. It sits on the bench quite solidly. It's 4.3 kilograms or 9.5 pounds for you US folk. And the passive speaker is 3 kilos. It's significantly lighter, and that's 6.5 pounds. And just so that they can add I to the title as well, it's, yes, you guessed it, got an iPod dock on the top here. And you sit your iPod in there, and it charges it, and I guess you can sync it, and you can play music through the speakers from your iPod. Whoop-de-doo. I don't care about that. I just want them as USB studio monitors. But for those who care, it's there, and I'm sure it works. So, what do they sound like? Well, that's obviously a hard thing to answer on this sort of medium, but they articulate speech pretty well. They do exactly the job I wanted them for, which is video editing. I like it, and they play music pretty darn well, as pretty darn good as well. Now, unfortunately, I'm in my office at the moment, and I haven't got my new acoustic paneling on the wall, so it could be a bit echoey. But what I've got is got my Rode shotgun video mic here. Pretty good mic, industry standard mic, and I'm going to put it up to the tweeter and the woofer and see if we can hear the difference. So let's play this thing and give it a go.
Welcome to the EEVblog, an electronics engineering video blog of interest to anyone involved in electronics design. I'm your host, Dave Jones.
Hi. One of the most common questions I get asked from beginners is, what do I need to buy to set up a basic electronics lab? Do I need all this stuff behind me here? What do I need? What should I buy?
And from a distance.
And test gear do I need? Well, it's a very good question. I've mentioned it often in a lot of my videos, but I thought I'd do a complete summary video on just the basic gear you need to get started to make a decent electronics lab, not just a lame-ass lab, a decent electronics lab.
And I can hear those birds in the background. No problems at all.
They see me mowing my front lawn. I know they're all thinking I'm so wide and nerdy. Think I'm just too wide and nerdy. Think I'm just too wide and nerdy. Get to see I'm wide and nerdy. Look at me, I'm wide and nerdy. I want to roll with the gangsters. Just too white and nerdy. I'm just too white and nerdy. Really, really white and nerdy.
First class here at MIT. Got skills, I'm a champion at D&D. MC Escher, that's my favorite MC. Keep your 40 out, just have an Earl Grey tea. My rims never spin, to the contrary. You'll find that they're quite stationary. All of my action figures and share
it. So, how much power does it draw? Well, around about 8 watts, just sitting there, not playing at all. It's actually switched on. And if we have a look at the VA, almost 24 VA at a power factor of 0.33. And it draws exactly the same, regardless of whether or not you have it connected to the computer at all. And that brings me to a little point. I would have, this power LED here, I would have liked to have seen that be a USB active or speakers active LED, because at the moment you have no idea, unless you try and play something, whether or not they're actually connected to your computer or not, and they're actually selected as the active output device. Now, I'm not sure if that's actually possible to do that, how easy it is, but that would have been nice. And it's a fairly dim blue LED too. It doesn't blind you if you turn the lights off in the middle of the night, which is a good aspect of product design. So there you go. If you're in the market for a pair of USB studio monitor speakers at a reasonable cost, you can do a hell of a lot worse than these. Let me tell you, they work well, they sound pretty good, and I think the construction's pretty darn good. It was much better than I was expecting for the money anyway. And they go for about $120, I think, for the 4 model. I don't know about the 3, it's probably under $100. But I'd recommend the 4-inch one if you got the room. And I like them. So do yourself a favor and pick them up if you need a USB studio monitor. See ya, and don't forget to subscribe. It's up there somewhere.